We go. So, welcome to our lecture on MPI groups, communicators, and one-sided communication. And as usual, there's a short outline and a slightly better image of me because I actually got a green screen for home. So I hope you can appreciate it now. I have some color. Anyway, we're going to talk about communicators and groups today, which are a means to limit collective communication. We always talked about collective communication and how expensive it is because it's global operation. It's a global communication operation. And we discussed today the means of limiting this to a smaller group of MPI ranks. Then we're going to talk about one-sided communication. One-sided communication is a performance enhancement, not only but mainly in order to be able to group multiple messages together, to aggregate them for more bandwidth. And we're going to talk a little bit about error handling. So, why do we talk about this? The problem is real-world applications are really rarely a single component. Often you have this MPMD programming style where you combine multiple libraries, multiple components, maybe even completely different executables. And you could have, for example, some chemistry simulation where you have a part of your code or a component that is doing molecular mechanics, and then there's another component that solves some really complicated linear algebra problem. And you might want to be able to do collective communication in one of the two without considering the other, because you only want to do matrix multiplication and, for example, gather the result at the end or something. So this adds new complexities compared to the single component software that we've had so far and that we dealt with in the pro seminar. If we do collective communication with MPI Com World, every rank will be involved that exists in our MPI universe. So that doesn't really help us in identifying sub-programs. You could come up with a really elaborate scheme where you identify ranks yourself manually, but then again, we learned that MPI tries to help us with that and tries to implement frequently occurring programming patterns, like with the neighbor communication, for example, and virtual topologies. So MPI offers something there. Let's see how we can do that. And MPI will show us how to specifically communicate between programs and within a program, all with collective communication. Another thing is NUMA topologies. So we know that we have this concept of comparatively expensive communication between nodes because we need to go over the network, and really fast communication inside a node because it's essentially just memory writing, right? Writing to a different memory address. And the problem is everything we discussed so far, including all the concepts on virtual topologies and so on, this doesn't really address the fact that some of our ranks have access to a shared memory address space and some ranks don't. And for the ranks that do, there might be something better we can do or faster we can do than just send and receive messages. So how are we gonna do that? We're gonna discuss that today. Another thing that I mentioned is we have, for example, unstructured grids with different types of elements, right? On the right, you have this figure that you already should know, where we have cells A, B, C, D, and E, and we have faces that connect these cells. Faces are numbered 1, 2, 3, and 4. And say, for example, we want to aggregate a certain property over all the cells or over all the faces, as I sort of tried to illustrate down here. We want to do a collective communication operation just for these element types or these element types, because, for example, we want to compute some error that only applies to a certain metric, but not for all of them. And this would be very useful in order to do collective communication operation. We would need to have a communicator per element type. But how do we do that? So the last thing in terms of the motivation is the shared memory thing I talked about. Consider, as we see on the right here, a shared memory node with 4 CPUs, for example, and you have access to all the memory in this node because it's NUMA, not uniformly, not with the same performance, but still you can access, and all of these accesses will be much faster than going over the network. It would be really useful to be able to limit collective communication to this shared memory node. But how do we do that? How do we construct a communicator that can do that? And especially, how can we do that in a hardware-independent way? It's not too difficult for you to do this yourself. You could just create a bunch of ranks with your MPI World communicator, right? And then query the operating system for IP addresses or for serial numbers and do all of this yourself. But that's not the point of using libraries like this. We try to use every level of abstraction available to us so we can stick with our algorithms and programs to a very high level of abstraction, and we don't want to deal with, for example, assembler instructions unless we have to, right? So there's something in an API that can do this, and that's what we want to have. Now, how do we address that? For communicators and groups, it's important to know that both of them exist and there's a difference, and we will get to that. But first of all, both of them hold sets of ranks. You already know this for communicators, you didn't know groups so far, at least I guess most of you didn't. You can use those directly for collective communication. Remember, they appear in all the collective communication calls. They are also required for identifying single ranks. Remember, every send and receive call needs to have source or the destination rank ID together with the communicator in order to uniquely identify a rank. And if you want to identify a message, you also need a message tag or something. All of these things in MPI are really relative to a communicator or a group, although so far you only use the communicator. Now the question is, why don't we stick to that? And I also already iterated on that. If we only stick to MPI com world, we can't really isolate our application. If we have individual processing steps with MPMD programs, for example, we can't do that. If we want to do domain decomposition, like for example SPMD style programs, and we do slices for Cartesian topologies, that's when we actually get a communicator that only contains a slice of our ranks, but we want to have more freedom in doing that. Can't we just create ranks, for example, that go across a diagonal or something like that? Or create a communicator that holds ranks that go over the diagonal. Connecting libraries, which also increases portability. Remember, I think I mentioned it once. If you write a library that uses MPI for parallelism, for parallelizing your problem, the first thing you should do in your entry point in your library is create a new communicator and not keep using MPI com world. If your library is used standalone in a sequential program, that's not a problem. If your library is used in another program that itself uses MPI, you run into problems. So the first thing you usually do is just create a new communicator and then you do whatever you wanted to do originally. Beyond that, it's quite useful to create new communicators because, for example, you can add user-defined attributes, like, for example, topologies, but there are more attributes that you could add. If interested, just check the MPI documentation. And also, it may be useful to create new communicators, even if they have the same size and hold the same ranks as before, because you can ask MPI to renumber them in order to get a more efficient neighboring relationship, for example. To have your virtual topology, for example, as we already know, match the hardware topology that we have, to match the network connections, to match the network topology. Now coming to the difference between MPI group and MPI com world, which is what I promised before, they're quite similar. So first of all, an MPI group holds an ordered set of ranks, right? It's a certain list of ranks ordered according to a specific scheme. Normally the ordering is given, for example, by the mapping of process IDs, which is what usually happens in Linux on rank numbers. And I looked this up at some point and for MPI, the specification doesn't really say whether this should be a process, whether this should be a thread or something else. The MPI spec, I think, only talks about processing entities or independently acting entities. And the important thing now, the difference between group and MPI, MPI group and MPI com is that the construction of and operations on the group are always local operations. This is extremely important from a performance point of view. I will show you later why this is so important in like one or two slides. MPI com world is a bit different because it holds an MPI group inside. It's like a struct that holds an MPI group. So transitively, it also holds an ordered set of ranks, of course, because the set is always ordered. It can hold additional attributes like topologies, for example. It's constructed from groups. So usually first you create a group and then you create a communicator. And if you don't, still it's probably something that happens in the backend without you noticing. And the important difference now for MPI com is that construction of communicators is always a global operation. So both of them have sort of the same characteristics in terms that they hold a set of ranks with IDs and everything. And in addition, MPI com world can do additional attributes and so on, and all the operations are expensive because they're global, and all the operations on group are local, and therefore they're comparatively cheap. Now, what are the operations that we can do in MPI group? For MPI group, basically, because they hold a set of ranks, we can do all sort of set operations on them. We can create them, we can create the union of two groups, the intersection, the difference, so those are set operations, you should know them. You can include and exclude specific ranks, or you could include and exclude a specific range of ranks, for example. And with all these functions, we can sort of construct a group that really matches the set of ranks we want to have for later use in collective communication, for example. There are some accessors compared or similar to the ones that you already know. So we can query the size of a group, we can query the rank of ourselves in this group, and also we can compare groups. So there's a group compare for which the result can be MPI ident, meaning it's the exact same set of ranks in the same order. Then there's MPI similar, which means you do have the same rank IDs in there, but they're ordered differently, or MPI unequal if none of the former two are the case. And of course, there's a destructor for clearing up memory and management that you're not using. Now, there are also operations on MPI com world, on the MPI communicator, sorry. For communicators, they can be duplicated in case you want to modify them with keeping your original copy. You can create them, you can split them. I will show later how this is useful. And there are also convenience constructors that you already used, like MPI card sub, which creates a Cartesian topology. You have accessors like comsize, comrank, you already know those. Again, also a compare operation, which can have the same results, so identical, similar, and unequal. And then there's an additional one, which is MPI congruent, which means it's similar in the sense that you have the same rank IDs, but they could be ordered differently, or because the communicator can hold additional attributes, two communicators are the same, but they just differ in their attributes. So that's what you get there. And of course, also we can destruct our communicator. Now, why is this useful to have those two? Why don't we only deal with communicators? I told you it's a global, creating communicators, modifying communicators is always a global communication operation, because you need to inform every other rank that this has happened. You need to sort of exchange the information, who is in my set of a communicator. So what you usually do to save performance is you start with the MPI com world communicator, then you construct groups of ranks in between. So I illustrated this on the right. And you can do increasing operations, you can modify your set, you can do a union, range include, exclude specific IDs because the root rank should not be part of it and so on, whatever. And you can keep modifying this group, all of these operations are really cheap, until you arrive at the specific set of ranks that you want to have. Afterwards, when you finished with that, you create your final communicator, and this is when your set of ranks will actually be communicated to every other rank. And this is relatively cheap because it's a single global operation. And all the intermediate operations here that construct your group and really identify the ranks, still every rank needs to do that. Every rank needs to do these operations, but for every rank, they're local. They're just local memory operations. There's no network communication whatsoever. And this is really a performance enhancement, especially if you have lots of these group modifying operations going on, and especially if this could happen dynamically while your program is running, not just at the beginning, but in a time loop, for example. Now, you can split communicators also. I told you before, I will show you how this is useful. MPI com split allows you to sort of split the set of ranks that you have according to very generic criteria. Specifically, this function I put, that's the reason why I put a function signature up here. First of all, it takes the current communicator, of course, because we need to start from somewhere. We need to have a handle by which to address all the ranks that we want to, you know, divide or split. And the second parameter is int color. And this is this is the thing that controls the subset assignment. So this is controls which ranks end up where by specifying different color values. So every rank that will use the same integer value here, this is just called color in the man pages in the documentation, but it's really just an integer value. And every rank that specifies the same integer value for this operation will end up in the same communicator. I have an example on the next slide. And then there's key, which controls the rank. Sorry, this is a copy and paste, sort of a copy and paste error. It should read rank ordering. If you specify zero as the key, the ordering of the ranks will be the same as in communicator. If you specify another value, then this value will determine the ordering of the rank in this new communicator. And of course, you have the output. That's why it's a pointer. Newcom, which will get you or give you your new communicator. And you can also use comsplit type if you don't want to split according to some generic criteria like the color that we discussed here, but rather according to some hardware characteristics, for which I have examples later on also. So how does comsplit work for doing something similar to virtual topologies? So on the left, you have example source code where we simply query our rank in our communicator. And then we compute the color, which is just my rank divided by 4. It's an integer division, so we will end up with the same color value for the first 4 ranks, for example, then another color value, but the same one for the next 4 ranks, and so on. And then we do a split operation with this color, with my rank as the key, which means ranks will stick to the same ordering as before, because these rank IDs were already ascendingly sorted before, so they will continue to be sorted like that. And then we create, then we query the new rank ID of the communicator, which if you remember also for the topologies that we talked about, whenever you create new communicators, the first thing you should really do is query your potentially new rank ID, because it could have changed in the meantime, right? And on the right side, you see what this looks like. So we had originally, say for example, 16 ranks. And now all of these are rank numbered from 0 to 3 in individual communicators with the color 0, 1, 2, and 3, and so on. And this is the idea of new rank, which could have changed. That's why we should always do this function call. So nothing too complicated, I guess. To show you how we can actually solve the motivational examples that we had in the beginning, because I don't want to present you with problems and not discuss how to actually implement them. Well, for the example where we want to divide communicators according to the topology of our problem, according to the element types of our problem for our unstructured grid, it's very simple. If we only have 2, for example, you could have the color simply depend on whether the element type is equal to type faces, for example, assuming that's the identifier for identifying faces, obviously. And then you do the comsplit, and then you end up with a communicator for everything that's faces, and then you end up with a communicator for everything that's not faces, for example. Assuming that you have or want to have a single rank that or a group of ranks that only works on faces, or faces only works on by one set of ranks. So this is, you can really just use any generic expression. The only thing you need to have, it needs to arrive at an integer value at the end. And on the right side, I show you how to create a new communicator that depends on hardware properties. So with comsplit type, you can specify several MPI constants here that allow you to address hardware topology entities. In this case, I'm using MPI com type shared, which means I'm addressing a shared memory node here. So if you do this, it's similar to hand coding this yourself as you would using the scheme on the left, using just MPI comsplit. You will end up with different communicators, but all the ranks that run on the same shared memory node will have the same communicator in the end, just like they would have the same color. And how this is implemented, because I keep telling that this is hardware independent, right? How MPI implements this is really up to the implementation. The point of view is that you don't have to deal with how many cores do I have, how they are ordered in my overall topology, what does my submission system look like, maybe what are IP addresses. You don't have to worry about any of those. Similar to OpenMP that tries to abstract away from using P threads or C++ threads, right? This tries to just add a higher level abstraction, an API that is one level above the low level thing that we usually had to do so far. And there are multiple options here. Using a shared memory node identifier is only one thing. You could also say, for example, I want to have a separate communicator for core. For cores, which makes sense if you have multiple hardware threads per core, for example, and you want to have individual ranks run on them. Most of the time, that could be quite a lot of overhead, but there are problems that will benefit from that, although many people would rather resort to using threads or not using hardware threading at all. Other identifiers for this are, for example, have the same communicator for everything attached to the level 1 cache, level 2 cache, level 3 cache, and so on. Really depends on the result that you end up with, depends on how are these shared. So level 1 and level 2 caches for now, for the hardware architectures nowadays are usually private. So this would probably be similar to core. Level 3 cache, most likely not. But then again, this depends on your hardware. And the important thing is here, you don't have to know. If you know that you want communicators that are split according to level 3 caches, you don't have to care how the hardware implements this and whether you run on an ARM system or you run on an x86 system or whatever. And there's another thing, which is actually the concluding slide for communicators and groups already. Might be a short lecture maybe today, let's see. You also have a different scheme categorizing communicators by whether they are inter or intra communicators. So intra communicators are the ones that we already dealt with so far. There's a collection of ranks that can send messages to each other via point-to-point or collectives, whatever, but it's really a group of ranks in the same communicator. MPI ComWorld is the most prominent example, and even if you create a new communicator with topologies and so on, all of these are intra-communicators. But there's another thing called inter-communicator, which allows you to do collective operations, for example, between communicators. So it's a collection of ranks from disjoint communicators, disjoint intra-communicators. And that allows you to exchange messages. So you could use this, for example, for communicating between library A and B if you know that sometimes they are used together and you could do some performance optimization besides the user, besides going through the user program and having the user do function calls that exchange information, for example. Apparently, this is a use case that's necessary because otherwise it wouldn't be in the MPI spec. But I have to admit, for real-world programs that don't use a ton of libraries, I see these quite rarely. I just put it up here to let you know that having different communicators doesn't mean your ranks are completely segregated and there's no possibility of talking to each other, but this happens actually quite rarely. Okay. I'm just gonna continue until somebody asks a question. Stream seems also to be working nicely. I guess there are no more issues here. Coming to talk about one-sided communication. I told you one-sided communication is an optimization for performance in order to reduce management overhead. Why do we need that? Because I don't think we did a detailed motivation on that yet. So far with MPI, we talked about the message passing paradigm. That means it fits distributed systems well because we talk over the network, so we need to exchange some kind of network packets. And we need data transfers that move data from one memory address to another distinctively different memory address space, right? And you need network communication. There's nothing besides that, except for, remember I told you about very exotic architectures like the SGI ultraviolet systems that try to put a cache coherence protocol on top of some network interconnects or something like that. So those are very exotic, almost nobody's using them, so let's not consider them here. And this paradigm requires explicit communication because we do have some message passing. If you don't write a send in your program, data will not be transferred. The problem here is that you have very little control over message aggregation, right? As soon as you do a send, you don't really know too much. If the send returns, if it's a blocking send, for example, you know that you can reuse the send buffer. You have no idea if the message was actually transmitted over the network, unless you use a synchronous send, for example. So depending on the message size, this could be buffered, this could be sent immediately. And the problem is, especially if it's sent immediately and it's still a quite small number of messages, this could cause a lot of overhead. Some of you who did some, I don't know, the current subjects of the bachelor and the master who did courses on networks might know TCP's Nagel algorithm, which has sort of the same purpose. So the Nagel algorithm says that if I send a lot of small packets, I will not send them immediately, but I will rather wait for the user program to aggregate a payload that is large enough to fill an entire packet, and then I will only send the packet because that increases my efficiency. That decreases, relatively speaking, the overhead of all the packet headers and so on. And if you do SSH connections, you want to disable that because if I press a single character on the keyboard, I want to see the effect immediately in my terminal, right? Now, this is all message passing and network communication. Different to that is shared memory, because we don't have any message passing involved, and we do have sort of data transfer aggregation, because if you do a memory write operation, you can immediately write a gigabyte, you have full control of how this happens, because it's just a write operation or a read operation in assembly, which will just happen immediately, except for cache coherence and so on, but nothing limits that from your API perspective. And this is much more convenient from the perspective of the user and the performance because you have full control over it, and from the user because it happens immediately. You don't have to consider, okay, this is a send, but I don't know if the information already arrived, if this function returns arrived on the receiving side, obviously. And also, in terms of performance enhancement for shared memory communication, you don't need the receiving side really to participate. For shared memory communication, I just write to an address space that could be read by another thread. I don't even need to tell this other thread. I should have some sort of form of synchronization in order to avoid data races, in order to avoid seg faults and so on. But the receiving side doesn't need to participate in the actual receiving of the data. It just needs to know now the data is there and that's it, which is different to a receive call in MPI. And again, stressing this point, sending messages even in shared memory is a lot of overhead, because I told you before that MPI can do optimizations. If you exchange messages via send and receive in the same shared memory node, MPI will just do a mem copy. It's not going to send message, or probably not going to send messages over the loopback interface with the loopback IP or something like that. Although implementations are probably free to do that. I think it's only an implementer guideline for MPI implementations that you should use the sort of shared memory communication paradigm here. But even if you do that, even if you do send and receive by just copying data in memory, you still have the overhead of saying, this is a send operation, am I in shared memory? If yes, I copy there, what's the tag of the message, and so on and so on. And all of this just for writing a few bytes to a different memory address. That's still comparatively a lot of overhead, right? So what is MPI's solution to this problem? MPI's solution is what's called one-sided communication. Now, why is it called one-sided? Well, the classic communication is point-to-point, and because we have two points involved, at least, it's two-side communication. And this always implies synchronization at every data transfer. So it's impossible for you to do a send and receive properly without synchronization. Even if it's a non-blocking operation, then at some point you need to do a wait or a test or something. And as soon as you return after querying test, I don't know how many times, or waiting after MPI wait finished, this is your synchronization operation. This happens for every data transfer. And if you send a lot of messages, there's a lot of overhead, because for every message, there's the synchronization. You might not want that. You might want to send 10 messages and only synchronize for the last one. Now, one-sided communication tries to decouple this. It tries to decouple data movement from synchronization and tries to do something that's more similar to what you have with OpenMP, where you just send, receive data, you just put and get. And after you're done, you have a barrier, or you reach the end of a work share construct that has an implicit barrier, and then you know I synchronized, I can move on. But the actual data exchange doesn't have any synchronization in there. And how does this work? The ranks expose a so-called window of rank local memory. So this is a memory region that every rank has, and the rank allows other ranks to write to its local window. We're going to see later on how this works in detail. This is also called remote memory access, so it's an RMA operation with MPI, not to be confused with more complicated versions of RMA or RDMA or something, where, for example, you can access GPU, VRAM, video memory from another node. There are also MPI implementations that allow to do something like that. This is more complicated, so here we're only talking about accessing the host memory, the normal RAM of or the small portion of it that is accessible to a specific rank. And the data accesses, which I will show later on, do not require any action for the receiving side, for the target rank that exposes the memory. So I just say, okay, I'm just opening the window now. Please get data from me, put data into my local memory. I don't care. And when I close the window, I will take a look and see what happened. When I close the window, I know all the data accesses have finished. What happened in the meantime, I don't know. And you can both use read and write operations for that. And because both reads and writes are possible, just like in, I don't know, HTTP, you have put and get, ranks really no longer identify as a sender and a receiver, because also the sender can just get data. So it's more called you have an origin rank that initiates the operation and the target rank that is the target of the operation. But the target doesn't participate in the data exchange. Now, how does the workflow of this work? First of all, we need to allocate a buffer that we can use. You can use malloc, you can ask MPI to allocate some fast memory, depends, but you need some sort of data space, you need some memory available. And then you create a window with that, which is the terminology of MPI for this local part of memory that you can access with other ranks. Once you have your window, you open your window, and MPI also calls this starting an epoch. The epoch is the time duration during which the window is open and you can access the data. It's also the synchronization point, which tells the target rank, now somebody starts accessing my data, and when you end the epoch, it tells the target rank, now all the data accesses are finished, you can start reading the data and doing processing with it. And in the meantime, you can do data accesses as many as you'd like. You can close an epoch, reopen another one, and again do data access, whatever you want to do. And once you're done, you have the final epoch end that closes the window and ends the epoch. And all the epoch endings are always the synchronization points where you say all the data accesses must have finished by this point. And afterwards, you simply I don't know, read the data, for example, and deallocate the window because you don't need it anymore. And if you don't need the data itself, you can also just deallocate the buffer. Now, to emphasize why this is one-sided communication and how independent this is of the actual target, I have another figure, another slide with figures that shows how this works compared to two-sided communication. So for two-sided communication, we have a sender rank and we have a receiver rank, and we have the send operation that sends data to the receiver, and ORG denotes that there is a data transfer going on, and the blue color here denotes that we have a synchronization going on, right? And both of them happen at the same time, so to speak, with MPI send and MPI receive. Again, this might be non-blocking if you do an iSend or an iReceive. You could have synchronous send or ready send or whatever. But by the time both of them finished, and if you do this correctly, you know that first of all, the data has been transferred and both of them have been synchronized. And there's a certain delay here that is incurred for the sender rank, because it could be that the send operation transfers so much data, you need to do a handshake operation, you need to do multiple packet transfers and so on. So potentially the send could block until the receive has finished receiving almost all the data, except for what's in flight through the network cards, the NICs. And this delay is sort of bad, right? Because we could do something here in the sender rank, just not wait for all the receiving operations to have finished and so on. And both of them are synchronizing at the same time for every message that we send. Assume we have multiple sends like a million of them, then we have a million synchronization operations. Now on the right side, we have one-sided communication where they are no longer called sender and receiver, but rather origin rank and target rank. And there are three different ways of synchronizing them. This depicts the first way, which is using window fences. So window fences are a collective operation. I will describe in more detail on the next slide how they are different from the others. Both of them here call a win fence, which means, okay, now we start an epoch. Then the origin rank can issue a number of put operations, a number of get operations to a window that's exposed on the target rank here. And the window fence starting the RM epoch here is the sort of partner of the window fence here that ends our RMA epoch, and in between we can do as many accesses as we want. And then we have again two window fences on the origin on the target rank, and then both of them know that the operation has finished. And in terms of synchronization, since it's a collective communication operation, they will synchronize. So neither the origin nor the target rank are allowed to move beyond this point until both of them, or all of them if they're more, called this window fence, and the same applies to the second window fence here. Now, I told you there are several ways of synchronizing, and you can group them into two categories. There's active target synchronization and passive target synchronization. And again, this is an increasing way, and for active target synchronization, there are two different methods. So there are three in total, two active, one passive. And they all progress with increasing performance and decreasing amounts of synchronization and communication involved. So for active target synchronization, the target also participates in synchronization. This is not the case for passive. For passive, the target doesn't even participate. It's similar to the message passing paradigm for active, where we say, okay, I synchronize, then I send a lot of data and again synchronize. But you could do multiple data transfers without synchronizing, but still the target needs to participate in the synchronization somehow. And either you do this with MPI WinFence, which is a collective communication operation, or with post-start complete wait, as they call it, which I will show on the next slide, or maybe the second next slide, which is not collective, but allows you to restrict the synchronization to a smaller group of MPI ranks. And in general, the active target synchronization works very well for this bulk synchronous type parallel programs, which means that you have some local computation, then you have some neighbor exchange or some communication operation, then again some computation and again some communication, and all of your ranks do this sort of in a lockstep. So it's not a very detailed or very fine-grained lockstep like in SPMD, SIMD programs where you have vectorization going on, but still all your ranks first do the computation, sort of the same operations just on different data. Then all of them do data exchange. Then afterwards again all of them do computation. Then all of them do data exchange. And because they are sort of blocked in this behavior, it's called bulk synchronous parallel. You will never have the thing where ranks are communicating while other ranks are doing communication, at least not on a larger scale. And passive target synchronization, on the other hand, I told you already the target doesn't synchronize, and because of that, it's sort of similar to shared memory, right? You can do data accesses a lot without informing the target, and in order to provide some locking and ensure that there are no data races, you can use MPI WinLock and WinUnlock, which are quite obvious in their use, I would say, by judging from the names. And this works very well for dynamic or independent access patterns. So assume, for example, because you think about, okay, why do I not want the target to participate in synchronization? It needs to know when the data is there, so why don't I do this all the time? The problem is, assume that you have an unstructured grid and the rank might not necessarily know all the neighboring ranks that want to send or get data from it. Or assume that you have something like an N-body implementation where you could have particles moving from one cell to an adjacent cell, and these two cells are owned by different ranks. You don't always want to have communication between all the neighbors, like in our 2D heat stencil, because you could have a lot of cases where you check with each other's neighbor, but there is actually no particle migrating from one cell to another cell. So you're sending an empty message just to tell the other rank there's no data to exchange. It would be much better if you didn't have any data to exchange to actually not do this send operation at all, to just do a send operation if you actually need to transfer particles. But this leads to a very dynamic communication pattern because then the target ranks do not know who wants to talk to them when the communication operation happens. You can't just do a receive operation without knowing whether you will actually get a message. If you do a receive operation, even with MPI any source or something, and there's no send operation that matches it, your receiving rank will just block, it will just hang. And if you don't know this before, if you have a very dynamic communication pattern where the target doesn't know the number of origin ranks that might get or transfer data to it, or you do not know if there's going to be any communication at all, you can use one-sided communication, you can use passive target synchronization, for example, and then if no data transfer happens, well, no harm done, let's just unlock the window again, or there might not have been any lock operation at all, let's just continue our work. Now, detailing on all of those three different methods of synchronizing, so the two active and the one passive one. For fence, I already showed on the first example, it's a collective communication operation. You don't specify the origin or the target because all of the ranks in your current communicator or group are involved. I already showed the figure before, so I'm probably not going to go into too much detail about those. All ranks that are involved control the epoch, so they all sort of start at the same time, they all end their own epoch on the same time. And when they do so, when they started the epoch, all of them exposed some local memory, and whoever wants to can access this local memory. And closing the fence enforces the synchronization. So this is pretty simple. Then there's the next one, which is the post-start complete wait. For this one, you can do selective synchronization because both origin and target actually specify a group they want to communicate with. They specify a group for which they want to synchronize. So how does this happen? The target rank issues an MPI win post, and the origin rank issues an MPI win start. And when start will synchronize on the target rank having posted the post call. So the start will not continue, it will block until a post has been called on the target rank. After this is the case, so after the start returns, you know that both of them issued these function calls. You can do all the put and get operations on the origin rank that refer to memory on the target rank. And once you're done with all your operations, you can call an MPI win complete. And on the target, you call an MPI win wait. And the win wait, you can call immediately after the post because it will block for as long it needs for the origin to call its complete operation, right? So win wait will synchronize on the complete operation. That's why I have the synchronization errors here. And this is something that probably you just have to learn by heart. They named these functions. They could have just named it MPI win 1, MPI win 2, MPI win 3, and MPI win 4. But that would be even worse, I guess. So for the target rank, you have the post and the wait operations. Post saying, I post this window out there, I post this information out there, and I will wait for all the operations anybody does on my window to be finished. And on the origin rank, you do the start call, which says, I start all my operations, and now I completed all my operations. This is just something that I guess you have to remember. And I mess these up if I don't talk about these for 3 or 4 months. I can't remember which one to do when. So, yeah. And yeah, I already said that these calls make synchronize, they may block to enforce ordering. Obviously, if you first call start and then you call post afterwards, this will synchronize. If the post has already been called, the start might continue with almost no delay. But the synchronization is enforced as I show on the figure. And now the last one, the passive target synchronization, because for the previous post start complete wait, we still have the target participating, right? And you could also have the target not synchronizing at all for these operations if you do locks. So here, if you do locks, the target is neither involved in a data transfer nor in the actual synchronization. It's like doing a mutex kind of lock-unlock operation on some, just not some local part of the memory, but a global or a remote part of the memory. The origin here has full control of the epoch, so the only thing that happens is I lock my window, but the information for my window is not stored in local RAM, but in remote RAM, so the main memory of some target rank. When I lock the window, I can do some put and get operations, and then I unlock my window. And this sort of resembles shared memory programming models in the sense that you also have this available with pthreads, for example, with std mutex and so on. You might have some other operating system facilities for that, depending on your programming models and your OS. However, it's not really the same, and you should be careful with that. You can't really use this to implement a critical section because it's so global, there's so much network communication involved. MPI doesn't really guarantee that this is that this ensures the full concept of a critical region in operating systems. If you want to read up on how this actually works and how to ensure that you can do a critical region with that, please be sure to check the specification. What you do with this win lock and win unlock is rather you lock a certain portion of the memory in order for you to be able to read and write data from that. That doesn't mean you can use the same region of memory on another rank and rely on MPI with the win locking to ensure that both of you won't access it at the same time or there won't be any data races. If you want to know the details, just check the specs about that or ask me. Now, what are the implications of the one-sided communication? Well, I already said, let's just iterate over those again. I said that we can have dynamic access patterns. The rank of the target might not know who's communicating with it, how much data is transferred should be known, sort of, because you need to expose the window. But you don't have to know necessarily how many ranks are sending data to you, what their rank IDs are, and if a ranks if you have any ranks actually transferring data to you. Then you can reduce synchronization overhead for multiple data transfers. I have some measurement on the next slide. Because you don't need to synchronize for every message, you just synchronize when you want to, when you finished all your send-receive operations, or put and get rather. You also reduce the management overhead on the receiver side. Issues like tag matching, for example, simply don't happen. You just access memory, you just write data to remote memory. And all of this gives you a performance gain, and also it reduces coding effort on the receiving side. With the passive target synchronization, for example, there's really nothing involved in the actual communication that needs to be there in terms of code, except for opening and allocating the window and so on. So The drawbacks is you no longer have any send and receive matching. So I told you that this is very beneficial for having dynamic access patterns, but because there's no send and receive matching, getting to know the communication patterns and getting to know how your program communicates is even more difficult. Consider, for example, that you don't have send and receives hard-coded in your code like we did with the neighbor exchange, but rather this depends on input data. You have an unstructured grid, or you have something like the particle transfers, where you check, do I need to transfer data? If I need to transfer data, I send a message that's not empty. Otherwise, I simply send a message and tell the other side there's no thing to transfer. That's okay. But beyond that, if all of the ranks are informed and if all of the ranks know about it, you could have dynamic send and receives depending on input data. And you could have flags in the input data that tell you rank 3 and 4 communicate or rank 3 and 4 do not communicate. So this would be very dynamic. The communication then depends on your input and not only on the static code that you wrote. This is already difficult to debug potentially in terms of performance debugging and also in terms of functional debugging, come to think of it. But if you do not have this send and receive matching, if you can just wildly access the data of other ranks, it gets even more difficult because it's harder to identify who talked to who and who sent how much data to what target rank. This is because these operations are not visible. We already discussed this for shared memory programming models where you don't have explicit data transfers going on or explicit send and receive going on. And the user is often responsible for writing the reads and the writes in a correct order. I have another slide on the sort of hidden semantics of RMA operations, which can get quite difficult. And you're responsible for doing this correctly, and you are responsible for ensuring there won't be any race conditions. And this is actually more difficult than it sounds, but I will detail that in a few minutes. And what you can do with this is only non-blocking communication, because your synchronization operations are separate from your send and receive, or your put and your get, rather. And when you do a synchronization operation with a win fence, for example, this is really your blocking operation. Before, you don't know whether a put finished, whether a get finished, you have no idea. I will show you on another slide. I think I have more details about that. And to show you the performance impact, so I keep promising these things that okay, it reduces the communication time, it increases performance. I did some measurements on LCC2 using OpenMPI 3.1.1. I didn't put the compiler up there, but I'm pretty sure it's the current version of GCC 8, I guess. OpenMPI 1 per host 2, which means I just have two ranks on two separate nodes communicating with each other. And it is a stress test, so it's an edge case, where one rank sends 100 million integers of 4 bytes each to rank 1. Which is just stupid, but it's one of these cases where you really say, I need a lot of send and receive calls, and that's what these one-sided operations should address and improve. So I need to have, if I do this just via normal send and receive, 100 million send and receive calls also. And if we run this on LCC2, we get 166 seconds. So I compiled this with O3, I guess. I didn't put it there, which is bad style. Sorry for that. And it's network communication, so the compiler optimizations probably have not that much impact compared to local computation like we compared before with our n-body problems and so on. And if we instead use one-sided communication and replace this 100 million send receive calls with 100 million MPI put calls and a single fence at the end, you get 73 seconds, which is a performance improvement of almost 2.3, which is quite a lot. And you have to consider two things here. First of all, yes, this is a synthetic benchmark, it's an edge case, so probably this is not what's going to happen in most applications out there. On the other hand, I only tested this between two ranks. Assume what might happen if you do this in a system with 10,000 ranks, and you might have less send-receive calls per rank, but the overall number is still quite large, and all of the other advantages that you get from one-sided communication, then this performance difference might be even larger. And even for the simple test case where I have two ranks communicating just by switching the code to something that imposes less synchronization on the target, reduces the runtime more than a factor of 2, which is a lot, I would say. Now, in order to have even further improvements, because the Window fences are collective operations. I told you before, collective operations we know are expensive. That's why before I showed you how to construct smaller communicators. There are even further optimizations that you can do here by telling MPI a little bit more about the semantics. So you have a fence that opens a window, you have a fence that closes a window, and in between anything can happen. Because anything can happen, MPI has to take several precautions when to overwrite buffers, when to access buffers, and so on. And we can help MPI by giving it more information of what's going on in the code in between and allow MPI to use more optimized operations. So we have four fence assertions here, as they are called. MPI mode no store, no put, no precede, and no succeed. And you don't have to use any of those. You can just, when you see the function signature of MPI fence and it says assertion or asset or something, just put a zero there. Then MPI will work correctly, your program will run correctly, it will just not be as fast as it could be. If you start to include those assertions, if they are safe to include, and that's up to you, the programmer, then you might speed up the program because MPI can choose a faster implementation. So MPI mode no store is an assertion that tells MPI the local window was not updated by a local store, a local get or a local receive call or anything like that since the last fence. So if I do a fence, this will be sort of the starting fence for my local window. Whatever happened before to my local window, you can just ignore because nothing will have happened there. Then we have the no put, which means the local window will not be updated by a put or an accumulate, for example, until the next fence operation happens. Then there's no precede, which means that the fence that I'm issuing where I put this assertion does not complete any sequence or any list of locally issued remote memory access calls. And no succeed means that this fence will not start any operations of this nature. There won't be any remote memory accesses that come after this fence. And again, none of these are required. You can just omit them, but you will not get the maximum performance out of your program compared to when you include them. But it's totally up to you to ensure that this matches the semantics of your program. And if you get it wrong, you will get wrong data because it's undefined behavior. If it's undefined behavior, your program might even hang or something, but most of the time you just get incorrect data. Now, there are four different so-called window models, which are just different types of creating a window, and I just put them up there because if you research how to open a window on the internet, you will find create on one page, you will allocate, you will find allocate on another web page, and then you know which one to use and what are the advantages. So let's just go through them quickly. There's WinCreate, which means you have already some buffer allocated. You provide the pointer and tell it, please use that as my MPI window for one-sided communication. Then there's WinAllocate, which allocates the buffer for you and uses it. So this allows MPI to decide where to allocate the memory. And for some certain implementations and certain memory architectures, MPI could choose to allocate this in some type of scratch memory, for example, that's really, really fast, but not cache coherent. So MPI is free to choose where to allocate this memory. Not sure how many implementations are doing how much optimization there, but at least the API doesn't prevent this optimization from being done in your MPI implementation. The spec allows it. Then we have MPI WinCreate Dynamic, which means we want to expose a certain buffer, but the buffer is not available yet. I just attach it later on with MPI WinAttach and with MPI WinDetach. Which again is sort of a performance optimization because it allows you to specify to MPI, let's do all the management of creating the window, exposing the window and so on, but the buffer that I will have for this window will only be available later in my program and I will attach it and detach it later, which for most basic cases is not necessary, just blows up the code, but there are some border cases where it's useful. And there's a special case here for the allocate, which is MPI win allocate shared, which means that you can allocate and use buffers in the shared memory segment of your operating system. And this only works for MPI COM shared, but this allows you to do some very, very fast operations because it's not only one-sided in terms that the target doesn't participate in the synchronization, but it's one-sided in the sense that you're really only using memory copy or write operations that really look like a pthread program or an OpenMP program. I have an example at the end of this slide set. And because we are really doing shared memory communication here, this only works in MPI COM type shared. So you can't use this with any other communicators, otherwise it's a malformed MPI program. So, just to put one of these function signatures for exchanging data up there, so you see what it looks like, and you see it's quite similar to a normal send and receive. We have the MPI put here, which has the parameters of the address, the local address of the origin of the data that we want to send, for example, because MPI put matches the MPI send function. Then we have count, which is the number of elements, and we have the data type, which is the type of elements on the origin side, which is quite similar to the send. On the receiving side, for the target, we need to identify the target rank, of course, because we need to somehow identify what is the other window where I want to put the data. So we do this with identifying the window by its rank. Then we have the displacement, which is the offset from the offset of the target address, where do I want to write the data, from the base address of the target window. So say the target window starts at byte 16 and I want to write at byte 4 of the window, then this will compute to 20 by 20 of the target address, and the displacement will be byte 4. And the base address will be byte 16, for example. And target count, again, the number of elements, obviously, then the type of elements on the target side, because remember, you can use this to change data types in MPI. We already discussed this in the past. And of course, you need a window handle in order to be able to address the window with MPI, so MPI knows which window to use for that. The target rank is not sufficient because you could have multiple windows, for example. And similarly to that, there's also the MPI get operation, which just is used the other way around for transferring data from the target to the origin, which is why we don't call them send and sender and receiver anymore. So this should be pretty straightforward, not too difficult, I would say. Besides put and get, there's also additional operations similar to the MPI reduce operation. We also have accumulate, which transfers data from the origin and accumulates atomically at the target. So you can only use some predefined operations, which are the same of MPI reduce, like MPI sum, for example, but you can also use this to implement an atomic put operation, which could then really, with the correct positioning of the locks or fences, you could really use to establish a critical region, for example, by using MPI replace as the aggregation operation, which means do a put operation by replacing some data, but I want this to be done atomically. And afterwards, on the next slide, I think I have functions that resemble what you already know, some of you probably, in terms of, for example, GCC intrinsics of doing a fetch and add or an add and fetch in this. MPI also offers functions like that, and this is how you then do critical regions if you really need to. For example, if you use MPI to implement a runtime system or an operating system or something like that. Similar to accumulate, there's also get accumulate. However, this stores the target buffer data in our result buffer before we do the accumulation. And if you want to do an atomic get operation, for example, without doing anything, you can use MPI NOOP, which just says transfer the data to me atomically, don't do anything on the target side. Or you could use MPI replace to get an atomic swap operation. And this is important because a normal get is not guaranteed to be atomic here, right? If you want it to be the atomic, you need to use an MPI get accumulate with the MPI NOOP. Otherwise, you can't be sure if this might be split up or when this might happen. Now, you also have single element atomics, which are performance optimizations. I told you before, they resemble GCC intrinsics, for example, or if we go to lower level, just x86 atomic operations. You have compare and swap, for example, which most of you I hope know, which is doing an atomic swap if the data at the target buffer matches a certain comparison value. It must be a single element, otherwise it's malformed, and it must be of predefined type, which can only be integer or logical or byte type. And why is this confined like that? Oh, surprise, because that's what most architectures actually offer as atomic operations. So you can't do a floating point with that. If you need that, then do a compare and swap or a locking on an integer. Then exchange your floating data and then unlock your integer again, which is what every compiler also does if you need atomics on non-floats. Also, there's fetch and op, which is a variant of get accumulate, and it's available for hardware optimization, as I said. Again, it must be single element, it must be predefined data types, and so on. So if you need to know more about them, just read them up. I'm just putting them here in the lecture on the slides so you know they exist, because these things can be sort of difficult to find on the internet. Just by Googling, I don't know, MPI atomic, you might get something completely different. Who knows? Just want to make you aware of how this works. And then we have a full example of MPI one-sided communication, what this looks like. So we have two ranks that exchange data. On the left, we have the origin rank. On the right, we have the target rank. And you see that the target rank is not participating in anything but the window fences because there is no communication operation here. There's no put, there's no get, no nothing. But let's go through it piece by piece. So first of all, we have our window and we have a certain buffer of type integer and a certain size with some data in there. However, this is initialized. Then we create our window with this buffer of a certain size and of the size of our element types. And MPI info would allow us to have additional attributes, which we don't need. So we just continue with the MPI communicator because MPI window operations are sort of collective operations. And well, we specify the window handle here that MPI needs to have access to. Then we do the winFence, and I tell winFence here no store, which means there were no local store operations up to this point for my window. Also, there will not be any put operations that address my local window, and no precede means there will be not only there will be no remote operations that address my local window, and that's it. So I'm basically telling MPI this is sort of a frequently occurring combination of attributes or assertions rather that tell MPI this is the very first fence for this window. Nothing happened before that. And this is information that you could, for example, automatically derive with a compiler, but MPI is just a library. MPI can't know about these semantics, so that's why you need to put it there yourself. If you use something that's compiler-based, like OpenMP or something smarter than that, this is information that could be derived, for example, in the compiler with program analysis, although it's really difficult to do. After we do this winFence, where we tell MPI this is sort of the starting point, our starting epoch, and we didn't do anything before with our window, our buffer, we use the put operation where we send data from our buffer of a certain size and type integer to rank one. With element one and no, actually rank one. This is okay. And size on the receiving side. MPI integer, this is I messed this up. Zero is the displacement, it's the offset from the base address of the target window. So it's the buffer, it's the size of the data you want to send on the origin side, the type of the data on the origin side, the target rank, the displacement address of the target window, where in the target window you want to write the data, the size of the data you want to write, the type of the data on the target side you want to write, and the window. If this is confusing, read it up in the documentation, but as you saw, I just messed it up myself. A lot of parameters. And this might be a point where zero is a bad integer literal. Just define it somewhere with an identifier, give it a name somewhere in your code so you don't make mistakes like I just did. It's always better to have all the numbers that you use in program, all the integer literals named somewhere and use them as variables. If you don't modify them, just make them consts or even const expressions in C++. Make them macros like preprocessor defines if there's no better way of doing it, but still that would be better probably than just hard coding an integer literal here. But again, on slides, I have limited space available. Anyway, after we do our put operation, we again issue a window fence. And we tell MPI again, there has been no store because there have been no local operations that write to our buffer. There have been no put operations that access our buffer in a writing way. But there's not any assertion that says no precede because I'm actually completing a put operation. So there is a preceding operation that is doing something. But I instead issue an MPI mode non-succeed here because there won't be any operations that follow afterwards. And when I'm done, I just issue a free and I'm done with everything. So that's the origin side. On the target side, I again have the window, I have the buffer of a certain size, which is my receiving buffer. If the types and the sizes differ, this wouldn't have to be the same. In our case, it's probably the same. We don't know if it's the same source file, but let's just assume it is. And what we do here is the same. We have the same window create call, unless I messed it up, but no, I didn't. So it's the exact same arguments, same parameters. Then I do a window fence with slightly different assertions because the no put is missing here because there will be a put operation that follows this fence. But there won't be any local operations, so there's no precede and no succeed. Then I do a win fence again, and you see there's nothing in between. There's no data exchange in between. There's no put, there's no get whatsoever. I do a win fence with the parameters. I don't have any no store here because actually somebody modified my buffer or potentially modified my buffer in between. But I can say that there's no put that I issued locally, and there's definitely no remote operations, no precede, no succeed afterwards. And again, I free my window afterwards. And these win fence operations start the epoch. So basically these win fence operations will collectively block and sort of resemble a barrier. These operations here will block. And in between, you can do as many operations as you want. I only did one of them. So you could have a number of put, a number of get operations, and the target rank just waits at this second win fence until we arrive at this win fence here. And then the target rank knows that all the operations finished, and we can continue with our work, whatever we want to do. Now, as I mentioned, it's only a single put operation here, and this is sort of important because usually you don't do it like that. Obviously, this is just a teaching example that fits on the slide with a certain minimum font size. But normally you do this with multiple puts and gets because that's what you want to aggregate. You want to reduce the number of synchronizations or synchronization points, and that only makes sense if you have more data transfers. If it's a single data transfer, don't bother. However, there's a lot of hidden semantics about these RMA operations. So first of all, the order of get and put accumulate or accumulate operations is not guaranteed. If you put out there several get and put or several get and accumulate operations or multiple puts or multiple accumulates, and they address the same target address, so they have the same offset of from the base address of the target memory, you have a race condition, because I have no idea in which order these operations are handled. It's not necessarily according to the ordering that you put in your source code. This applies for having get with any write operation, which is put and accumulate, for example, but this also applies for multiple put operations. If you need this to be possible, if you need this to be atomic, use the accumulate operation that I showed before with the specific accumulate operation type that ensures this operation to be done atomically. Otherwise, you have a race condition. And again, even if you do this locally, even you figure out you run it 10 times and it works, your program could still be broken. So if you move to a different architecture, a different MPI implementation, your program could potentially somehow produce segmentation faults, produce incorrect data. So really try to code accurately and don't just code it up, compile it and run it. And if it runs without any errors three times, assume your program is correct. Always give yourself the sort of benefit of the doubt that you screwed up, and be sure to try to do this correctly. Okay, that's the first thing. The second thing, you must not have any local access to your window during an access epoch. So you could have, for example, you could have a local window, obviously, that is addressed by some other rank. You could be the target of some communication operation. If this is the case, you're not allowed to access this window, your own window, while an epoch is open, because some other operations might be happening at the same time. If you really need to do that, you also need to use an RMA operation on yourself, basically, if you need to have that. A much better way of doing this, or usually a much cleaner way of coding, is to simply not do this at all and simply open the window, have all the others do their operations, close the window, and only afterwards operate on this data, operate on this window if you need. However, it's even worse than that. It's not only that you cannot use your own window that might be accessed by somebody else, but you are not allowed to use the send buffer after a put operation, for example. So say, I will jump back to the previous slide. If we have our buffer here and we do the put operation, this put might immediately return. Between this put and between this fence here, you're not allowed even to read officially the buffer, because MPI would be allowed to reorder data inside your buffer while this entire communication operation is pending. And only after WinFence, MPI would potentially restore your buffer, and you're allowed to reread the buffer again. So the specs actually prevent you, they tell you you're not allowed to do that. You can, of course, do it in code, but it's not guaranteed what's going to happen. It's actually undefined behavior. And this is what I said about hidden RMA semantics, because when the put operation finished, you would say, okay, It might not have completed really. It might just happen at the WinFence, because WinFence is the synchronization point, but I'm only sending data. It's read only for my local buffer, right? Not necessarily. MPI doesn't guarantee that, so be careful with that. And that's why you need to be careful with knowing when an operation finished locally and remotely. Just because the local operation finished, just because the MPI put operation, the function call returned, doesn't mean you're allowed to use the send buffer, so to speak. You need to wait until the next synchronization point that addresses that. Also, you have no concurrent passive synchronization epochs, you're not allowed to have that, to the same target. So this is really only relevant in a multi-threading context, but you could have, for example, passive synchronization where you open, you have origin and target ranks, or you could also call it source and target. That's still valid in terms of what's happening. And if your origin is multi-threaded, for example, you must not have multiple passive synchronizations in terms of lock and unlock in individual threads of your source rank. Because the MPI doesn't guarantee how these operations are ordered. And because this is only relevant in a multi-threading context, usually there's no problem here. But still, you should be aware and remember that also I put this up in one of the, I think it was probably the MPI Advanced lecture, the first one, where you can query MPI for what threading support it has, whether it's MPI serialized, MPI funneled, or MPI multi-threaded, and so on. And still, if you have multi-threading capabilities, then this is something that you're not allowed to do, even if your MPI implementation matches the highest level of thread support. And yeah, there's a lot of MPI fence optimizations that help you with increasing the performance. We saw the assertions of no store, no put, and so on, no precede, no succeed. But the problem is the question of where you put them and which ones to put there. It's really up to you. If you screw this up, your program is wrong. If you take the conservative approach and you don't put anything there, and whenever you need to specify an assertion, you just specify zero, your program will probably run correctly. However, you will sacrifice performance. So this is like what I would call the naive approach. If you want to optimize your program, first code it up naively, don't put any assertions there. And afterwards, you see that the program finished, revisit your program and think about, okay, these are the assertions that I can put there. Then rerun it and see if it's still correct. And try to get it correctly done by looking at the source code, because it's just if your program runs correctly, doesn't mean it's actually not malformed, you know. So I mentioned it several times. Now, the last thing you can do with one-sided communication, which is really neat, is shared memory one-sided communication, which I told you before. MPI had the disadvantage for quite a while, and this was not part of the very first version of MPI of 1.0, that other programming models like OpenMP allow to simply access data of another thread. We are all in the same process image, right? We all have access to the same global memory, unless we declare a variable to be private or things like that. So MPI doesn't allow that, so OpenMP probably has a performance advantage because there's very little overhead in just writing to memory. Now, MPI obviously wants to compete with OpenMP in that regard, not just because they are sort of separate companies, separate universities, and they try to fight each other. And the MPI group says that the OpenMP guys are doing things badly and this bad programming model, and the other way around. Obviously, none of this stupid stuff. The point is that often when you need something like that, people resort to MPI plus X, I told you already, and specifically here, MPI plus OpenMP. So you use MPI to have a single rank per CPU or per NUMA domain or even per node, for example. And within the CPU, within the NUMA domain and within the node, you then use multiple threads, OpenMP threads per rank, in order to use the full resources available on this topological level that you chose, whether it's CPU or node, for example. And the problem is, if you combine these two, then you have to deal with the MPI plus X issue. You have to deal with two separate programming models. You have to deal with the interaction of both. You need to learn both. So it's not possible to just visit an MPI lecture and then do this hybrid programming approach, because you're not going to know anything about OpenMP, and the other way around also. And even if you know about both, it's often very difficult to get it right in terms of performance, because there's lots of hidden semantics and hidden things like cache coherence and register coherence and one-sided communication over the network and so on. And getting these things right can be difficult. So that's why the MPI specification group decided that they also want to introduce something like this shared memory communication in order for you to be able to do that fully in the MPI world, not using OpenMP at all, but still having access to this shared memory style programming pattern. You're not going to get any threads out of that. You still need to use different or separate processes, but at least on the same shared memory node, you can just access data without any put or get operation even. So what happens here is that the origin of the data transfer will actually just get a pointer to the target address. And you can just access it, write to it, read from it, whatever. But naturally, only this really only works for ranks that are in the same physical address space, because otherwise the pointer is not going to mean anything. If I transmit a pointer over the network, it's worthless. So this sort of resembles POSIX shared memory segments. Guess you could even use those then to implement some locking, for example, because as soon as you have access to a memory address, just use any type of locking operation should work. But would be very, very strange programming style. But just to show you what works in backend here. And one of the main advantages why we do this is the performance gain. I already talked about that. But the other big thing that should not be underestimated is it allows you to reduce the memory footprint. Because, for example, you don't have to have necessarily, I have an illustration later on, any extra buffer for the ghost cell exchange of your stencil operation. You can just read and write data exactly to the cell where the data needs to be. And all of these shared programming models, also with OpenMP, you usually try to do that because you do not need to copy memory. Because even if you have read-only data, if you work in separate process images and they all access the same read-only data, you need to have a separate copy of that in memory. If you have proper paging in the operating system and so on, it could be that the operating system sees, oh, these are read-only pages, I only store them once, I refer to the same hardware addresses by doing the virtual memory address mapping correctly and so on and so on. So all of this stuff might happen in the backend, but the MPI is not aware of that, and the MPI still gives you the opportunity to just access the data of another rank on the same shared memory system in order for you not to need to do a send operation or do a put operation that works on a different buffer, which is a copy and introduces memory overhead, right? And yeah, the increased efficiency about intra-node communication I already talked about, and it's even faster than one-sided because you don't have any put or get operations, you just access memory. There's no function call involved. So how does this work? I told you about an illustration. We have the ghost cell exchange when using message passing, even in shared memory. So what we have here is we have a bunch of, so this is a 2D heat stencil, for example, and we are not showing any of the computational parts here. We're only showing communication. And we have data exchanges that happen here with the dark blue arrows going outside a node. So the blue line here, this rectangle, denotes the boundaries of a shared memory node. And all of the things happening outside here are going over the network. The light blue arrows here denote communication that goes on inside the shared memory node, for which we don't want to have any message passing overhead or any one-sided communication overhead even. And how can we optimize this? Because we have two copies here, right? This is a copy of data that probably resides here. So for the same shared memory node, we could simply omit those and have direct memory accesses with this shared memory one-sided communication operation. And then you remove the ghost, or you can remove the ghost cells here that are no longer necessary, which reduces your overall memory footprint. And you might consider now, okay, this is really not a lot, right? Because considering the two-dimensional growth of this area here, if I increase the problem size per rank, my ghost cells for each of those will only grow in one dimension, so it will be less. But consider this could be a three-dimensional problem or a four-dimensional problem where this is no longer the case. Where also your ghost cell sort of borders are multidimensional. And depending on the type of problem you have, it could be that you have a large number of cells or a very small number of cells per rank. So don't necessarily rely on assumptions like that just because a figure is only showing a subdomain of 4x4 here in this case. And how do we actually code this? Well, we can use comsplit type for that, as I've showed earlier in this lecture. So we split the communicator along the lines of a shared memory node and get a new shared memory communicator out here. Then we use win allocate shared, which tells MPI, please allocate the window buffer, but I want to use shared memory one-sided communication, so that's why I need to use the special function call. And what happens then is that you really get a receive buffer out of this function. So you get a pointer that's written to, that's why it's actually the address of a pointer, which otherwise would probably be a coding error. But MPI then gives you a pointer that you can use, and you do a WinFence locking operation on this window. Because you created this window with win allocate shared, it's only synchronization among the local ranks of your node. And then, and this is the sort of core part, this is really where we get to the meat and potatoes of today's dish, you simply write to this pointer, which is a local operation, a local memory write operation that will just be some store or something in x86. There's no message passing involved, there's no MPI operation involved because there's no function call here. This is really just an X, if you compile to x86, it's just an x86 instruction here. And this replaces your MPI put call. And besides the window allocation and besides the synchronization with the fences, this is the lowest overhead that you can probably have because you directly access the main memory. And this is pretty neat that you can do this in MPI. The downside, I would say, is that this still can be sort of complicated. So as soon as you do something like this, you need to be sure which pointers you're using, which offsets from some base address you might have, how large your window is, because you have multiple ranks that just write to the same window without any synchronization in between. And the issue here can be really that you run into the same data race issues that you run into when you use OpenMP, for example. You are asking whether we need to use the... That's a very excellent question. I'm not using the shared memory communicator here. That's a very good question. That seems sort of strange. I think this is wrong. Thanks for letting me know. I will check, and if this is wrong, and I assume it is, because I'm using MPI com world, I will update the slides and update the correct slides. I think you're correct about that. Sorry, that's a mistake on my side. Okay, thanks for noticing. Yeah, other than that, this is how you do MPI data exchange with the least amount of overhead and hopefully the maximum amount of performance that you can get on a shared memory node. You have to be careful, however, that the efficiency of your operations really then depends on the x86 instructions that you use. Before, you used send and receive operations or good put and get operations, and MPI in its library implementation is free to decide what kind of instructions to use, whether you use a loop to iterate over elements of an array or whether you use a memcopy array operation or something like that, right? That's completely up to the library implementation. If you use something like that, all the code that you write in there is translated one-to-one to assembly using the compiler that you use, and MPI is not doing any optimizations there. So most of the time, this is less overhead and higher performance, but it's really up to you to then use this efficiently. And all the low-level optimizations for specific architectures that you have in threaded programming, for example, also apply here. Like how much you have memory bandwidth and whether you use some vectorized instructions or something like that. Okay. A little bit more about MPI and multithreading, because this is actually a really important topic here. Having one-sided shared memory communication, I already hinted on it, can be really complex, and there are these alternatives. I mentioned most of these things already before, but I have a slide for that. I forgot that I actually have it. You can use MPI plus OpenMP or MPI plus STD threads or P threads or Intel thread building blocks or something. And lots of people do that, but they all have their ups and downs in terms of advantages and disadvantages, because you need to deal with two different programming models that both need to be studied and both need to be learned. You need to master both of them. Then you need to know about the potentially complex interactions, like I have below, for example, somewhere on here. I don't know, MPI thread single, funnel, serialized, and multiple, which tell you whether MPI actually supports multi-threaded programs and to what level, to what degree. I thought we had that in a previous lecture. We didn't. I have it up here, so we're going to discuss them now. And whether you use one-sided shared memory communication or you use MPI plus OpenMP is really up to you. Just try to stick to one of those and try to, if you do this parallel systems programming after studying my course, which I hope you do because you're so fascinated by the topic, Personally, I prefer MPI plus OpenMP because I think nothing beats OpenMP in its simplicity of doing directive-based programming. However, you have to really think on two different levels and you have to think about performance interactions that might happen. One-sided shared memory communication has the advantage, for example, also you don't need any compiler support. It's only a few function calls that you do. But OpenMP is widely supported by most compilers these days. So yeah, this is almost like a question of religion, I would say, or a question of belief. But yeah, and if you tune them enough, you can get MPI programs without one-sided shared memory communication to almost the same performance or the same performance as OpenMP programs, for example, on shared memory nodes. With one-sided shared memory communication, it's even easier. And the other way around, also OpenMP programs can achieve the performance of an MPI program on a shared memory node. It just depends on the amount of optimization that you do. So if people tell you one always beats the other, they probably don't know what they're talking about. Now coming to speak of the MPI thread support, MPI is a library. Library function calls can be made from a single thread or multiple threads in the same process. So you need to know whether these functions are re-entrant, whether you support multiple threads IDs, and so on. And MPI indicates this with several thread safety levels, single, funneled, serialized, and multiple. So single means that MPI only, and you can query these with MPI tools like OMPI info or something like that. They're command line tools that tell you all these MPI settings and you can query MPI to see what levels it supports. I don't have the command line tool up here, but if you Google for it, you will find it. MPI single tells you that MPI, your implementation, only supports a single thread per rank. You can't do any multi-threading whatsoever, or at least MPI doesn't guarantee what's going to happen when you do. There's funneled, which means MPI does support ranks that are multi-threaded, but only the main thread is allowed to do calls to MPI. If you have MPI plus OpenMP and you use funnels, that means all your MPI calls need to be in a master region. So a region identified by a master pragma. That's why they have this master directive. Then they're serialized. That means you support, or the MPI implementation supports, a multi-threaded rank. And it doesn't matter which thread of the rank calls the MPI functions, but you can only do one call at a time. You can't have multiple MPI calls pending concurrently. This is not allowed. And the last thing is multiple, which means basically multi-threaded, any thread can call any MPI function at any time at the same time. Not exactly. There are a few restrictions, which usually are not a problem if you don't do too fancy or too complex coding. For example, one of the restrictions that's not allowed is you can't have for two threads of the same rank, two collective communication operations that happen at the same time and involve this rank and the same communicator, for example. So this is something you can't have interleaving, because that would start to interleave collective communication operations, and that's where things get wrong. But come to think of it, when is that actually necessary? When you have multiple threads that try to do two different collective communication operations at the same time. Has to be a border case, I would say. But still, other than special cases like that, with MPI thread multiple, which most mature MPI implementations out there support, you can just do any calls at any time, also concurrently. The important thing to note here is that MPI implementations do not require to support more than MPI thread single. So if you're not sure, check this before you're programming, because if you start with a very young, so to speak, MPI implementation, it could be that it really only supports MPI thread single, and then it fulfills the specification. There's no reason to go anything to any higher. Of course, then people will probably not use the implementation. What you should do is you should always check beforehand. And the funny thing that we didn't mention so far, when you initialize your MPI library for multi-threaded programs, you should always do an MPI init thread instead of MPI init. Most MPI implementations try to do this correctly without too much overhead in any case, but if you want to do it correctly, you need to call MPI init thread if you work in a multi-threaded context, and not just MPI init, because that violates the specs. Okay, last topic, error handling, which is only a few slides, so we're almost done with the lecture for today. The problem with debugging, and we're going to have, I told you, a separate lecture on debugging, MPI introduces lots of additional problems that we have besides our usual problems anyway. So imagine everything you can have that could go wrong with a sequential process. You could have segmentation faults without parallelism. You could have a crashing program without any parallelism. You could have your program hang because of some file descriptor stuff, whatever. Whatever you do, sequential programs are already sort of difficult to get right. Put on top of that the fact that you have multiple processes, multiple sequential processes that interact with each other over the network with varying latencies, bandwidths, and so on. Gets difficult. So that's why MPI introduces some type of error handling that many of you probably already used without realizing it too much or without giving it any additional thought. The default behavior is that communication errors, at least for the OpenMPI implementation, will abort MPI operations if the implementation notices there has been an error. For example, if you try to use shared memory style operations on a communicator that is not a shared memory communicator. Or if you screw up other arguments of MPI send and receive operations or something like that. This will cause the MPI rank where this error happened to exit, and it will cause all other MPI processes to exit also in the application, because at some point there might be some information spread through the system that tells the other ranks something went wrong, let's just quit, or they will just hang until some certain timeout and then exit. But this can be difficult because it could be there could be a timeout of a few hours, for example, because there's nothing in the MPI spec that asks the receive function implementation to wait for a maximum of, say, 60 minutes or something. There's nothing in the spec. So what happens usually is either all your processes will exit immediately, or your job limit, your resource manager, Slurm or SG or whatever, will simply kill your job after you reached your hard limit. The problem with this really only relates to halting crashes where your program crashes immediately or it's just not responsive anymore. You could have deadlocks that are a bit more obscure, or you could also have data corruption errors, for example, which are much harder to debug. So I really like errors where my program doesn't compile or it crashes, because those are the things where you know something went wrong. Think about your program just finishing seemingly correctly and just computing the wrong result, but you don't know the result it should compute beforehand, so how do you know your program ran correctly? And this all refers only to the easier errors that have your program, for example, crash. Now, how do we use error handling? Well, all MPI routines return error codes. I guess most of you didn't use them so far, and I don't do this on my slides because I don't have the space for it, unfortunately. But still, having said that, you should always, like with every other function call that returns an error code, examine the error code and see if anything went wrong. If this was not the case, if everything succeeded, you will get MPI success as the return code. And if this is not the case, if you have MPI functions that failed, you should take appropriate action. Similar to, for example, a malloc failing. So people always say, okay, if a malloc fails in my program, there's pretty much nothing I can do anymore, because probably I ran out of memory, so I will just crash anyway. What's the point? This might be true, but consider of other resources that you might have allocated, like file descriptors, for example, or other resources that you locked, GPUs or whatever you might have, depending on what programming model you use. Try to make it clean. Try to think about stuff other than just memory allocation that you might need to free, and try to free this up correctly. Because it makes debugging easier and it makes it faster for the operating system to free those resources, even if your process is a zombie or just sort of hangs or something like that. And what these cleanup operations actually entail is up to you and your program. Now, the default behavior is that errors are detected and you will simply abort, which is nice because for OpenMPI, for example, you get a nice output on the terminal that for most cases even tells you what you did wrong. But if you call MPI comset error handler with MPI errors return, these error codes will actually be returned to you in the MPI function calls, and you can take action in your program. If you set it to errors are fatal, your program will simply abort, which for most of our teaching examples might be sufficient, but for larger applications might not be. You can also install user-defined error handlers. If you're not happy with either of those options, then use the functions create error handler. And if you want to set it, use the set operation. If you want to know which handler you set it to, use the get operation and so on. Again, just to notify you, these possibilities are out there. If you're interested in those, please read them up yourself. That sort of concludes not only this lecture, I have a summary slide, I think, but also it concludes our MPI lectures, which I think we had three of. And because this is the last lecture on MPI, I just want to mention a few additional topics that are out there so you know they exist and MPI can help you with stuff like that. There is MPI file IO that helps you with partitioning data among multiple processes, strided file access, for example, that sort of match derived data types, which is really nice. If you know that you only need every 20th byte, you can also write programs that only read every 20th byte from the file that you will want to deal with without having to code all of this up yourself. You can have asynchronous data transfers and so on and so on. Then there's a huge topic of process management, how to spawn processes, which we really didn't talk about. Remember, I told you in the beginning, we just assume that with job submission and MPI run or MPI exec, we assume that our ranks will be started. We are not going to look further at this starting overhead and how to do this efficiently. There are some topics in MPI there, and there is even research that allows you to start additional ranks, for example, when your program and the application is already running. So allow ranks to be added to your communicator after your application started already. And this is where it gets really researchy and academic. So many implementations do not support this or do not support this properly. And I think nobody's using it, to be honest. At least I didn't see any programs yet. There's socket style communication, for example, if you want to communicate between sockets in the same OS and so on. Then there's a bunch of Fortran specific issues for some of you who might do Fortran programming. I guess for none of you this is the case, but who knows? These have slight difference in the differences in MPI function signatures or how you use them. And especially for the one-sided operations, you need to provide additional functions to help the Fortran compiler identify which optimizations are allowed and which optimizations are not allowed in order of writing data back from registers to registers spelling correctly and stuff like that. And there's a bunch of profiling support, which we're going to get in a little bit into in the debugging lecture. So it's really neat that MPI is a library and as such offers a header file because you can simply, and the library, because as such you can simply wrap all the MPI library calls with wrappers, for example, where you do a start timer, then I do my send operation, and then I my end timer, and then in my performance or in my profiling library, I can simply time all the MPI operations that are available and that are used simply by exchanging which library do I link against or which library is loaded, depending on how you compiled, and which header file is being used in case you need additional signatures of the functions or something. And this is really handy. And this profiling support is something that the MPI group and also OpenMP is trying to actively promote. And why they try to add features with newer versions, they try to make profiling easier. Because writing correct programs nowadays is not that difficult, but getting the highest performance out of it is. And this is also just an excerpt of the additional topics that you can look into for MPI. The spec is quite long and there are lots of books. So if you want to read some of those, let me know. I will find some references for you. In any case, this concludes today's lecture. So we talked about communicators and groups that offer you a high-level control over ranks and allow you to group ranks in sets that are not just part of a Cartesian topology, for example, and allows you to really do set operations to first create a group, which are all local operations, and then you move from the group to the communicator, which is only one global operation or collective operation. And once you have your communicator, you can just do collective communication operations only within the ranks that are part of your group. Then we discussed one-sided communication operation, which is a little bit more difficult to use, but it can improve performance because for one-sided communication operation outside of shared memory, the target rank doesn't need to participate and you can reduce the amount of synchronization. And there's even one-sided shared memory communication, which allows you to just write to a buffer of to a pointer of another rank in the same shared memory node, which is really handy. And we discussed error handling, which allows you to choose between having your program being torn down by the MPI library, so to speak, if you do not handle the errors yourself, or you could do graceful exits by telling the user what could have gone wrong in terms of the domain of your problem, in terms of semantics, and not just error with, okay, I have a send operation with a mismatching receive or something like that, stuff that could go wrong. You could provide the user with some additional information. And with that, I conclude the lecture.